Welcome to Steps to Life. Ask the beasts, and they will teach you. And the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. And the fish of the sea will explain to you. Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?
We have been instructed, if you want the reference, one place would be in Life Sketches, page 196. We have been instructed that we do not have anything to fear for the future, except as we forget how the Lord has led us in the past and His teaching in our past history. And so it is important for us to study and review how the Lord has led us in the past. And right now, by the way, and for several months, we have had a committee at this church who has been studying the foundations and pillars of the Christian faith. And to understand these properly, we need to study religious history. I personally have been studying on my own again, not that I have never studied it before, but I've been studying again the history of the Second Advent movement. Very, very interesting history. When you study it, if you have the same experience that I've had when you study it, it becomes confirmed in your mind beyond a shadow of a doubt that divine providence led in the development of the Second Advent movement. It wasn't something that just happened. It was something that by a whole series of miracles happened that led to the development of a Second Advent movement, not just in the United States, but also in other parts of the world. And the devil attempted to destroy the development of the Second Advent movement clear from the beginning. And at every step of advance, the devil has sought some way to try to destroy it. Now, last night, I thought, although I knew I had to preach today, I thought, well, it'd be all right to spend just a few minutes of just pleasurable reading, just a reading for my own pleasure. And so I was reading about the 1848 Bible conferences. And at the 1848 Bible conferences, when they first met, Ellen White said there were hardly two people that agreed. Just total disagreement. How are they ever going to sort things out? They got together and they began to study the Bible, and they had certain leaders, certain individuals who had studied out certain things, and they came and they made presentations, and people were all there following along with their Bibles. Joseph Bates made presentations concerning what he had been studying that showed conclusively that the Bible taught that the seventh day was the Sabbath, that the fourth commandment taught the observance of the seventh day Sabbath. And so he made presentations on the seventh day Sabbath. And James White and others made presentations on the subject of the sanctuary. And so as you study these things and you look at the development as these doctrines develop, by the way, just a few years before that, in 1844, the Millerites did not know about the seventh-day Sabbath. You're all aware of that. In 1844, the Millerites, those that were expecting Jesus to come in 1844, did not know. They were not keeping the Sabbath. They did not know about the Sabbath. Ellen White, her name was Ellen Harmon then. She wasn't keeping the Sabbath. I don't believe that James White was either. And the Millerites were not keeping the Sabbath, and they didn't even know anything about the sanctuary in heaven. So by 1848, they were presenting these things in these Bible conferences. And as you begin to study the history of how the different doctrines developed, it didn't happen all of a sudden. It happened over a period of years. This is also very interesting to me to study. You know, when God leads people and when He teaches people, God knows how much you can comprehend today. And so God doesn't teach you more than you can comprehend and change today. He doesn't teach you all the things that now we humans, and I'm included, we don't have that skill. We have a tendency to just really lay it on somebody and just you remember we read in our scripture reading this morning, Jesus said, "I have many things to say to you, but you can't endure it right now." So He didn't say it. For the rest of their lives, the disciples were asking, what would He have told us if we'd have been ready to hear? But they weren't ready, so He didn't tell them. He did promise them, though. He says, when the Holy Spirit comes, He will bring to remembrance what I've taught you. So I hope that you will pray for this committee that is meeting together to study the foundations and pillars of the Christian religion, because we need to be able to make very clear the doctrines that were developed as the Lord led out in the development of the Second Advent movement. And by the way, the Second Advent movement was a development that took place out of all the different churches, including the Roman Catholic Church. All the different Christian churches were involved. And I've told you before that when I was a boy, my parents were Seventh-day Adventists, but when I was a boy, we never even called ourselves a church. In fact, we said we were not a church. We used to preach that. We used to say that we Seventh-day Adventists, we're not a church. We are a movement that God has called out of all churches to prepare people for the second coming of Christ. That's what I used to hear preached when I was a child. And that, you know, I haven't heard that for several years, quite a few years, but that's what I used to hear when I was a child. And so we need to understand how the Lord raised up the Second Advent movement. And some of you here might know how my brother used to interpret Matthew 24, where Jesus said, "This generation shall not pass." He said, "The generation that shall not pass." It's talking about the movement that was generated in the last days when the time of the end would come and the 2300 days would come to an end. The movement that was raised up at that time, and that's the time, of course, that Jesus is talking about, because he's talking about immediately after the tribulation of those days when the sun is darkened and the moon shall not give her light and the stars fall from heaven. He's talking about that time, and he said, "This generation shall not pass." That's a very interesting passage to study. By the way, the many different preachers have many different interpretations of that passage. Adventists used to believe that there were people that were alive in 1833 that would still be alive when Jesus would return the second time. The last time I can remember when I heard of that being preached was about 1954. That's about the last time I heard that doctrine preached. But the thing that was generated, the way my brother interpreted that text, was the thing that was generated, that would be generated, which was the Second Advent movement. It will not pass away until everything is fulfilled. The devil, though, has tried over and over again to destroy it. And one of the devil's most forceful attempts to destroy the Second Advent movement was through a man that had been one of our most talented ministers. When I was in the seminary, this is Berrien Springs, Michigan, this is back in the late 1960s, I took a class in the seminary, Seventh-day Adventist Seminary. I took a class on the Sabbath. The whole class, what we studied was the doctrine of the Sabbath. We went through the Bible, the doctrine of the Sabbath, and what does the Bible teach about the Sabbath? And so part of the assignment in this class, our instructor said, "Now, I don't want you to go and just read from the Ellen White writings about the Sabbath, but what I want you to do, I want you to go down here to the James White Library," that's a big university library at Andrews University, "and I want you to go to the Seventh-day Adventist periodicals, and I want you to go through there, and I want you to spend I don't remember how many hours we had to spend, but a certain number of hours, and you go through those periodicals, like the Review and Herald, and I want you to find every article that you can find that was written by our pioneers about the Sabbath, and read it." So I was doing that. I was going to the library, and they had these large bound volumes of original copies of the Review and Herald and Signs of the Times and so forth. It wasn't photostat like we have in our individual libraries. They had actual original copies. And so I was thumbing through those books, and I was reading different articles about the Sabbath. And I was shocked at what I was finding, because I never expected to find this. I found that there was a certain minister that seemed to be superior to every other minister that we had that was writing in the Review and Herald at that time in his ability to explain the doctrine of the seventh-day Sabbath. Now, in my humble opinion, his writing was superior to Uriah Smith or any other author that we had. He had an analytical mind, and he could present evidence in the most forceful way. And this minister had one problem. He was so talented that he knew that he was talented. That's why, by the way, anytime there's a really talented young Bible worker or young minister, you need to pray for that person, that the Lord will help that person never become lifted up or exalted in their, have an exalted opinion of themselves. This minister was so talented that he knew he was talented. And one time he asked a friend of his, he had an appointment to speak at a very, very large church in Chicago, Illinois. And he asked this friend of his who was going to be with him at the meeting and was going to listen to him speak. He said, "I want you to listen to my sermon, and I want you to critique it, and I want you to tell me anything that you hear or see that I did wrong so that I can improve." He said, "Okay, I'll critique your sermon." So this man was sitting, and this minister, this Seventh-day Adventist minister, got up, and he preached a sermon on the inheritance of the saints. I should preach a sermon on that sometime. I love that subject. You know what the inheritance of the saints is, don't you? And he preached a sermon. These are not Adventists, but Protestants. He preached a sermon to them on the inheritance of the saints. And when he got done and the people had gone, he talked to his friend. He says, "I want you to critique my sermon." And the man said, "I'm sorry. As soon as you got up to speak, I was so spellbound by what you said and what you delivered, I didn't even think about critiquing your sermon. I don't if you did something wrong, I don't know what it was. I was spellbound the whole time." He was that kind of a preacher. He could hold you spellbound as long as he was speaking. And this Seventh-day Adventist minister said to his friend, he said, "Well, if it wasn't for this unpopular message, the second Adventist, the Adventist message, Seventh-day Adventist, if it wasn't for this unpopular message, I could be a great man." And that because of his high opinion of himself, the devil was able to attack him. And eventually, he not only left the Seventh-day Adventist church, but he wrote a book called Seventh-day Adventism Renounced. And when I was at the seminary, I got a tape. And this tape was an interview of a lady. She was an old lady then. This was back in the late 60s. Who was a young lady when this book was written, which was before 1920. And she said, "I was Ken Wright's secretary." Now, there's been a book written. I have it in my library. "I was Ken Wright's secretary." It goes into that whole situation. And when D.M. Ken Wright left the Adventist Church for the third time, he left twice and came back, but when he left the third time, Ellen White warned him before that if he left the next time that he wouldn't come back. When he left that third time, the devil took control of that man against his will. My friend, your only protection against his demonic power is the protection of Jesus Christ. And by the way, that's true for everybody in the world. I don't care whether you're a Christian, whether you're a Hindu, a Muslim, or whatever religion you are, your only protection against demonic power is the power of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ protects the heathen and the people from things they don't have any idea. And when he left the third time, the devil took control of his life. And this lady, I listened to it on the tape of her interviewing, an interview of her, describing how
when he would dictate this book, Seventh-day Adventism Renounced, she says it was sort of a fog would come over his body, and then he would start to speak in a different voice. And she said, his face looked so terrible, I could not look at him. So I turned my back, so I would just take shorthand or take the notes of what he's reading, because I couldn't look at him. And then after a while, he would have to take a break, and he would start to cry. And he would say, Ellen White was a good woman. And after he would cry for a while, then he would sit down, and he would start to dictate, this mist would come over him again, and he would start to dictate the book, and be a different voice, and she would take down the notes. She said, there's only one other time in my life I ever saw a mist like that. But she said, I think it was in Benton Harbor, Michigan. She says, I saw a light with a mist like that around it. And I thought, my, that's just like it used to be. She says, I went in and inquired, and that was a meeting room for spiritualists. And when D.M. Canwright used to come after he had left the Seventh-day Adventist Church for the last time, when he used to come sometimes like to prayer meeting, the devil would not allow him to pray with our people. And when they would kneel for prayer, if he would try to kneel down to pray, his whole body would just lift right up off the pew and off the floor. The devil would not allow him to kneel down and pray with the Seventh-day Adventist people. If you haven't read it, you might like to read sometime the book, I Was Canwright's Secretary. Why do I bring this to your attention? Well, when I was a young minister, and I would give people Bible studies, and then, of course, our opponents would give them literature to prove that we were wrong and prove it was all right to keep Sunday. And so then they would give me this literature. So over the course of time, I would have all kinds of literature. In fact, I have whole books in my library that attempt to prove that it's all right to keep Sunday. I have several books like that, written by people with doctor's degrees in theology and divinity and so forth. And so I would receive these books. And after a while, and I couldn't sort out, I thought, where did these people get these arguments? Where did this come from? It was some years before I got it all figured out. These arguments against the Sabbath, showing that it's right to keep Sunday, almost all of them are derived from D.N. Canwright's book, Seventh-day Adventism Renounced. Now, almost clear to the present day, most of the arguments that we meet that attempt to prove that it's right to keep Sunday, you don't need to keep the Sabbath, and all those, most of them actually derive from D.M. Canwright's work, Seventh-day Adventism Renounced. Now, he was one of our most forceful preachers and writers concerning the seventh-day Sabbath. Now, how does somebody that is one of your most talented ministers in preaching the doctrines of the Second Advent and who's part of the Second Advent movement, how does he completely go off? So that he completely loses his way and his life is taken over by Satan. It's a very, very sad story. Now, I'm not the judge, but I have no expectation of meeting D.M. Canwright in heaven. I have none whatsoever. I'm not the judge. I just have to look at the evidence and let the Lord be the judge. But I bring this to your attention because today we have renewed attacks on the internet and in all kinds of literature against Ellen White, against the Sabbath, against the Second Advent movement. And when you look at these things, they've got, such a long list of arguments. You look and say, I'd have to write a whole series of books to even answer the questions. Where do these arguments come from? We have a whole group of people now, led by former Adventist ministers. They have an association of former Adventists. They have chapters at Berrien Springs and Redlands, California, and Phoenix, and different places. And so they've written books. One of the books that they have written is called The Cultic Doctrine of Seventh-day Adventists. And this is written by a former Seventh-day Adventist minister. And, of course, this whole book is meant to attack the doctrine of the investigative judgment. And so I thought, well, what can he attack it with? What does he have to attack? So I looked through the book. In fact, I looked through the whole book.
I was very interested to find. Do you know who he has gone to for advice to help him understand, get his new understandings? D.M. Cartwright. That's who he's been reading to get advice, to print books, to help Adventists not become Adventists anymore. So, I'm getting too long-winded. We're talking too long, and I want to read to you at least part of a dream that Ellen White had. This dream was specifically concerning D.M. Cartwright, and this testimony was sent to D.M. Cartwright. And I can see right now I probably won't be able to get done tonight. We'll just get as far as we can and leave it there. But I was going to entitle this study, The Two Ships. Because today we often hear people say, oh, the ship's going through, the church is going through. Well, the question is, which ship is going through? Are you sure that the ship that you're on is going through? And so let me just, if you have the testimonies of the church in volume 5, about page 571, I think it is where it starts, this is the way it starts out. She says, Dear Brother M, now, just that's all it says in your testimonies, but I'll tell you who she's talking to. She's talking to D.M. Cartwright, one of our ministers. And this is what she said. I had an impressive dream last night. I thought that you were on a strong vessel sailing on very rough waters. Sometimes the waves beat over the top and you were drenched with water. You said, I shall get off. This vessel is going down. No, said one who appeared to be the captain. This vessel sails into the harbor. She will never go down. That's the Second Advent movement. But you answered, I shall be washed overboard. As I am neither captain or mate, who cares? I shall take my chances on that vessel you see yonder. Now here's the problem for you to figure out. What is the other vessel? What is the other vessel? There's two vessels. He's on one. The captain says this vessel's going through, but he wants to get on another one. There's another vessel he wants to get on. What's the other vessel? Said the captain, I shall not let you go there, for I know that vessel will strike the rocks before she reaches the harbor. You straightened yourself up and said with great positiveness, this vessel will become a wreck. I can see it just as plain as can be. The captain looked upon you with piercing eye and said firmly, I shall not permit you to lose your life by taking that boat. Notice, if you get on the other vessel, you're going to lose out. You're going to lose eternal life. The timbers of her framework are worm-eaten, and she is a deceptive craft. Now listen carefully to this. There's two vessels. They both look the same. This person, D.M. Cartwright, he's looking at the other one and said, I'm going to get on that one instead of this one. I'm having too hard a time on this one. I'll be safer on that one. And the captain says, no, it looks all right, but it's a deceptive craft. In other words, it looks all right, but it's not. The timbers on that vessel are worm-eaten. Now, you know what a timber is that's worm-eaten? It looks fine on the outside, but it's not. If you had more knowledge, this is the captain speaking to him in her dream, if you had more knowledge, you could discern between the spurious and the genuine, the holy and that appointed to utter ruin. Now we're going to run out of time, so I just want to ask you this question. This is something for you to think through in your mind. In the dream, there's two vessels. To human vision, it looks like the one's better than the other, but the one that looks best is actually the worst one. It's going to crash. And the captain says to D.M. Cartwright, he says, if you had more knowledge,
you can discern between the spurious and the genuine. I want to ask you a question. Can you discern between the spurious and the genuine? That's a serious question, isn't it? Because if you can't and you get on the wrong vessel, what is going to happen? You're going to crash. If you had more knowledge, you could discern between the spurious and the genuine, the holy and that appointed to utter ruin. Then Ellen White writes this. That was the dream. I awoke, but it is this dream that leads me to write to you. I was feeling deeply over some of these things when a letter came saying that you were under great temptation and trial. What is it, Brother M? That's D.M. Can, right? Is Satan tempting you again? Is God permitting you to be brought to the same place where you have failed before? Will you now let unbelief take possession of your soul? Will you fail every time, as did the children of Israel? God help you to resist the devil and to come forth stronger from every trial of your faith. Be careful how you move. Make straight paths for your feet. Close the door to unbelief and make God your strength. If perplexed, hold still. Make no move in the dark. Let me ask you this question. Have you ever been perplexed? Have you ever had two different people trying to convince you of two different things in theology or something else, and you're trying to sort it out, and it's just perplexing? Well, what do you do? Now, notice the counsel. If you're in that kind of a situation, maybe there's two or more people, and they're trying to persuade you of opposite points of view on some point of faith. What do you do? Now, notice this counsel. If perplexed, hold still, make no move in the dark. I am deeply concerned for your soul. This may be the last trial that God will grant you. Advance not one step in the downward road to perdition. Wait, and God will help you. Be patient, and the clear light will appear. If you yield to impressions, you will lose your soul, and the soul is of great value with God. There are some people that when they're in perplexity, it seems they can't wait. They have to know now, so they're just going to take a position. Don't do it. By the way, if you have gone to worldly schools and worldly universities, you maybe have had advisors that would even tell you to do that in worldly things. They say, Don't jump until things become clear which way you should go. If things aren't clear yet, just say, well, I have to have more time. I have to pray about it more. Don't jump when things are not clear. She's gone to say, I have been writing upon the first volume of Great Controversy, and it makes me feel very solemn as I review these important subjects, creation and the events from the fall of Satan to the fall of Adam. The Lord seems very near to me as I write, and I am deeply moved as I contemplate this controversy from the beginning to the present time. The workings of the powers of darkness are laid clearly before my mind. Most trying times are before us, and Satan, clad in angel robes, will come to souls with his temptations as he came to Christ in the wilderness. He will quote Scripture. And unless our life is hid with Christ in God, He will surely bind our souls in unbelief. And then she says, she's writing all this to D.M. Can, right? Time is very short, and all that is to be done must be done quickly. The angels are holding the four winds, and Satan is taking advantage of everyone who is not fully established in the truth. I have another question for you on that. Are you fully established in the truth? I don't want to make you feel bad, but I want you to think seriously. And I want you to know that you will never become fully and thoroughly established in the truth just by coming to church. And I'm not trying to get you not to come to church. That's not the point. But it takes more than coming to church to become fully and thoroughly established in the truth. That's why we have things like prayer meetings, and preaching revival services, and Bible classes, and baptismal classes, and other materials to help people to get rooted and grounded in the truth. Are you rooted and grounded so that when the wind blows and there's all kinds of theories, that it doesn't bother you because you're anchored and see, it just doesn't, you just don't get pushed around this way and that way. The Bible says, Paul talked about that. Look what he said about it. Look in Ephesians 4. He talked about this very thing. It says, look at Ephesians 4, verses 13 and 14. It says, till we all come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness by which they lie in wait to deceive. There are people that are carried about by every wind of doctrine. If you're carried about by every wind of doctrine, well, then you're not anchored anywhere. Sometimes, some of us who have spent some years preaching have gotten together and talked about this very thing and asked this question among ourselves. How is it that in a church, you can have a preacher get up and preach something, and in the same church, the next week, you can have another preacher get up and preach something that is completely different and doesn't agree, and you'll have people, if they have a good delivery, you'll have people to walk out the door and say, that was a good sermon. Say, wait a minute. Something's wrong. Something's wrong. If you believed this week, you shouldn't have believed last week, and if you believed last week, you shouldn't believe this week. But there are a lot of people, even in Adventist churches, that are not anchored. And so they can be pushed back and forth with various winds of doctrine. And you all know that in our prophecy seminars, we say to the people, we say, now look, please, don't believe anything because I said so. What I say is not important. What's important is what the Word of God says. And what we're preaching, if you can't find it in the Word of God, well, then you better not believe it. But if a person has not been studying the Word of God so that they're anchored in the truth, well, then they can get pushed back and forth. I'm sure that you all know that there, even in Adventism, there are many, many different theories flying. In fact, there's more different theories flying about today than any time that I can remember. I can remember the time. It's in my lifetime. When an Adventist was an Adventist. And when I was in college, and we studied about the history of the Second Advent movement and of the controversy about different doctrines, our teacher said, well, you know, yes, they were having controversy about this and this and this, and he said, yes. That was in the past. It's not in the past anymore. What we thought 50 years ago was in the past has been revived. In fact, that's a matter of fulfilled prophecy. Ellen White said that as we draw near the end, she said the old controversies will be revived and new controversies will constantly be arising. Have you noticed any controversies arising? There's so many arising that I don't have time to study them all. I have a whole stack of materials. There have been people that have adopted a teaching. Now, I know it's wrong, because I've studied the Bible a little bit. So I know it's wrong, but I don't have time to research all the details out about it. There's people that have been studying, they have come up with a doctrine about a lunar Sabbath. Have you heard of that? And the problem with the lunar Sabbath is the people that believe in the lunar Sabbath, they have the Sabbath coming at different days of the week throughout the years, just like the ceremonial Sabbaths did. They have the seventh-day Sabbath coming at different days of the week. Well, friend, that's not true. Read your Bible. The Bible's very, very clear on that point. But there's all kinds of new teachings coming up today. The old controversies that When I was a student in college, this teacher said, the students said, well, this is what they were arguing about. That was in the past. We didn't even think about it. Nobody even talked about that. That had been settled many long years ago. It's not settled anymore. And by the way, the devil does not forget which types of controversies are the most successful to get the churches all split up and destroyed. He doesn't forget which are the most successful. And we're going to have to be ready to meet all these things again as we approach the end. And you won't be able to meet them because of something that I preached in church or something that Pastor Nunez preached or something that Brother Hoppe preached. You won't be able to meet it with that. You'll have to know for yourself what the Bible says. You'll have to know for yourself. Friend, I hope you're studying. I'm not trying to be overbearing on you, but I hope you're studying. You won't be ready just by listening to preaching. And preaching is important. The Bible says it's important. But that it's not enough. That's enough to get you started. But then you need to do some study on your own in your Bible. And she says, Satan is taking advantage of everyone who is not fully established in the truth. Every soul is to be tested. Every defect in the character, unless it is overcome by the help of God's Spirit, will become a sure means of destruction. I feel as never before the necessity for our people to be energized by the Spirit of truth, for Satan's devices will ensnare every soul who has not made God his strength. The Lord has much work to be done, and if we do what he has appointed for us to do, he will work with our efforts. That's a wonderful promise, isn't it? Now, this was a testimony that was given to Elder D.M. Canright, who was one of our most talented ministers. He was both one of our best speakers and one of our best writers. He was one of the most talented ministers in Seventh-day Adventist ranks. But he went out and he wrote this book, Seventh-day Adventism Renounced, and that book has provided the ammunition for Sunday-keeping pastors, which they didn't have much before, to attack the doctrine of the Sabbath, the doctrines of Seventh-day Adventists. And by the way, in this book, he doesn't just attack the Sabbath. He attacks the spirit of prophecy and non-immortality of the soul, all sorts of things he attacks in this book. He will be along with a lot of other people who it's possible that he will have to give an answer for millions of people that have been deceived by his writings. And as I mentioned, Seventh-day Adventist ministers today that have left the Second Advent movement and are preaching in Sunday-keeping churches or raising up their own community churches, Sunday-keeping churches, we find when you look at their works, where did they get their information? They got it from D.M. Canright. Now, if you want to, it's very interesting to study the history of D.M. Canright's life. Ellen White told him when he was going through this experience, he said, your son will set in obscurity. And that literally happened. He got a job as a pastor of, I think it was a small Baptist church in Michigan. Remember, he said to his friend, Brother Revis, he said, oh, if it wasn't for this message, I could be a great man. Well, when he left the message, did he then become a great man? No. It was the message that made him what he was. It wasn't him that could have been a great man if it wasn't for the message. It was a message that made him what he was. John the Baptist understood something that I'm trying to learn. I read this scripture over and over and over. I'm trying to learn it. I don't claim to understand it, but I'm trying to learn it. This is John the Baptist speaking. John 3:27. John answered and said, a man can receive nothing unless it has been given to him from heaven. A man can receive nothing. except it be given him from heaven. D.M. Canright thought that he would be a great man if it wasn't for the Adventist message, because this was so unpopular. I would never deny that it's unpopular. But I decided a long time ago, I would rather be unpopular with men and do what God says than be popular with men and not do what God says. What do you think about that? And so D.M. Canright thought if it wasn't for the Sabbath and preaching something that was so unpopular, he would be a great man. He found out he wasn't a great man. He died in obscurity. In fact, if it wasn't for the book he wrote on Adventism Renounced, people wouldn't even know who he was. In fact, most people still don't know who he is. Even the people that read these new writings that come from his works, they don't know who he is. They don't know where they got their information from, and they do not know that they're getting their information from a man who was taken complete control of by satanic agencies after he left the Second Advent movement. And over again, you remember Ellen White said, this may be the last trial God grants you? Did you hear that? This may be the last time. He'd already left twice and come back. He's getting ready to leave the third time. He did leave the third time. And when he left the third time, he committed the unpardonable sin. And satanic agencies took him over. And like I told you, when he would come to the prayer meetings in Battle Creek at the tabernacle, when he would try to pray, he couldn't pray. The devil wouldn't let him. His body would raise right up. I heard this from eyewitnesses, people. His body would raise right up from the pew or the floor, but the devil would not let him kneel down and pray with our people. He knew the truth. When he was dictating the book, from time to time, as I told you, he would take a break and he would start to cry and he would say how that Ellen White was a good woman and he would admire the Adventist people. But he committed the unpardonable sin. There is such a thing as the unpardonable sin, you know. There's a sin that you can commit that if you commit that sin, God says, all right, you can go the way you've chosen. And the devil takes control of your life. In 1915, this was just a few years before D.M. Canright died, in July of 1915, Ellen White died. Now, she died in California, and they had a funeral service in California, but then her body was transported by train to Battle Creek. Any of you that have ever been to Battle Creek, you can go to the cemetery in Battle Creek, and James White and Ellen White and their children, they had children that died before they did. They had four children, and only two of them survived. The others died young, one about 16 years of age, and one as a baby. And they're buried there. And so, after she died, Ellen White's body was transported by train to Battle Creek. And if you look at the last part of the book, Life Sketches, it gives the funeral sermon that was given at her funeral in 1915 in Battle Creek. At her funeral, D.M. Canright was present. Now, there was a lot of people present. And they did then, very similar, just about the same, as we do today. At a funeral, at the end of the service, it is customary, not always, but it is customary to open the front of the casket. And the dead person's lying in the casket, face up, of course, their eyes closed, and they're all silent there. And then, the way we do it now is that we usually have the deacons, they let the back row out first because the relatives of the dead person are generally sitting up toward the front. They let the people from the back come up and go past the casket. Well, they did that those days too. And they did that at Ellen White's funeral. And so, different people were coming up and going past the casket. And D.M. Canright came up and he stopped right in front of Ellen White's casket. And he began to cry. And he said, "There is a godly woman gone." And after a while, he regained his composure, and then he walked away. But although he knew the truth, he knew the Adventist people, he knew the truth of the Adventist message, after he rejected it and walked away from it the third time, he'd committed the unpardonable sin, the devil control of his life. And if you think that he wrote in his book that Ellen White was a godly woman, you just could look in his book. I wouldn't advise you to look, unless you're rooted and grounded in the truth. I wouldn't advise you to read his book. It'll absolutely flip you. If you are not rooted and grounded in the truth and you read his book, it will flip you. You won't be able to answer the arguments unless you're rooted and grounded yourself. But I tell you that story because you need to get to the point where people can come up to you with the arguments of D.M. Cantwright or whatever arguments they want to come up to you with, and it won't flip you because you're rooted and grounded in the truth. And you can't be blown around this way or that way. And you're not thinking about getting on a different ship. But this man that she had this dream about, that he was going to get off and get on another ship, she said, "If you follow your impressions, you will lose your soul." And I want to tell you, friend, that's true for you and me too. If we just do what we think is right, we have no assurance of heaven. Notice what the Bible says about that. Look in Proverbs. This is the same text as in Proverbs 14:12 and in Proverbs 16:25. It says, "There is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death." You can't do just what you think is right. I can't do just what I think is right. We have to know from the Word of God, what does it say? And am I living according to the Word of God? And I have to be rooted and grounded in what the Word of God says, so if the whole world tells me I'm wrong, I still know what the Word of God says and I can live by it. I apologize that I only got through the introduction to what I wanted to study with you about. We'll have to study the rest another time about the two ships. But I hope this story of D.M. Cantwright is helpful to you as you meet, and if you haven't yet, you're going to meet arguments against the Sabbath, against investigative judgment that are based on what Cantwright said. And the only way you can meet those is if you're rooted and grounded in Bible truth yourself. And we try in this church to see that everybody gets instruction. We want to have people get instruction. That's why we have prayer meetings. That's why we have classes. That's why we have services like this, so that people get instruction. But please, friends, please remember, no matter what we do, we cannot get you rooted and grounded unless you're doing some Bible study on your own, too. We can't do it. We're going to do the best we can to help you, but we cannot get you rooted and grounded so you're immovable and cannot be pushed back and forth unless you're also doing some study on your own. I hope you got a Bible study program. Regular. Let's pray before we go. Father in heaven, we pray that you'll help us to learn from the experiences of history, and especially the experiences of sacred history. And when we study the lives of others who have lost their way and brought grief to the universe of heaven because they have caused the destruction, influenced other people to also lose their souls, we pray that you'll help each church member, each family and each member in our church, everyone that visits this place, help us to get in a Bible study program to become rooted and grounded so that we cannot be pushed back and forth with every wind of doctrine. Lord, we want to know what you tell us, what you teach us in your word. We want to have our faith grounded and exactly what the Bible says. And we pray that you'll help each one of us as we study, that we might become rooted and grounded, immovable in the truth, so that we cannot be pushed back and forth by all the winds of doctrine that are abroad today. Bless each person as he or she studies your word with an understanding, an increasing understanding every day of the truth for this time. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number? He calls them all by name. By the greatness of His might and the strength of His power, not one is missing. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above all the earth.